situation. You don't fuck around like that, man. Tell you, it ain't no good for the blood stain. You know, goddamn, whatever. Diamond, baby.
Diamond, baby.
Get out. Not the cow. I'm going to go with the show. Check it out.
Niggas want to touch my steez. Nigga, please. I black that eye like peas. You better breeze in your tracks. A rat tank. Killer bees on your back. I come for the honey, but the fat money sack. You want it all? Yeah, I want it all like that. I stab my own moms in the back for a stack. Niggas like, damn, why you want it like that? Cause I'm a dog and I got no love for the cats. Attitude's cold like the North Polar caps. Where I do my dirt's a little further down the map. A little buck wildin', Allen goes stats. When niggas carry gats and they black money hats. Now I'm at known for the loans and the raps. And he's an unknown with a faulty contract. Wake up, it's brother, bet you motherfucker contact. Rollin' in a cypher and I'm throwin' head cracks. An Indian giver and I'm about to take it back. Shallon, Allen, baby, where you at? A runaway train that be running on your tracks. That's how it's going down, yeah, it's going down.
I got my thing in action. To live, to love, to see, to learn.
Yo, tell her what's happening.
What's happening?
What's happening?
I tell you what's happening.
Tell her what's happening.
It's going on out here.
I swing funky rap routines and tap your jaws. Spot your 20 points and you still can't score. Nothing, cause you ain't got no points in this game, kid. You frontin'. I'm home run hitting, you be buttin'. Brush out the toilet, I got my shit together. When I'm good, I'm good. When bad, I'm better. You want it, whatever. I'll be the stormy weather. Rain coming down, the weather with your leather. Jacket, a nigga with an axe. Couldn't hack it, I spark him like a match. Coming back, it's the matchin'. Say it loud or dimension, man. Clap your hands, now check it. See me in the lid from my back, busting flicks on my physical. Mother came through and got me lit. Niggas, now I walk by, give me the eye. The moment is fucking me up, killing my eyes. Nigga, get back, you pussy cat. I'm fearsome, basically that. I'm all of that, and then some. Voila, was out on tour, but went berserk. I heard you was at the sandbox and kicking dirt. All of my name, but you can't pull my foul. You don't know me, and you don't know my style. Remember that day like that, damn, yeah.
Inviting the national black community to participate in a two-way conversation with its black leaders. During a pre-recorded 90-minute special to be shown nationally at 8:30 p.m. on May 15th, 12 major spokesmen will answer your questions. Last year's program was a tremendously successful experiment in the use of television as an instrument for positive social reform and two-way communications. Among our guests this year are Stanley Scott, Special Assistant to President Nixon, Congressman Lewis Stokes, Chairman of the Congressional Black Caucus, Judge William Booth, Angela Davis, Percy Sutton, President of the Borough of Manhattan, Stokely Carmichael, Fannie Lou Hamer, and others. We invite you to call in your questions to this distinguished forum tonight, April 24th, immediately after Black Journal. Call 212-582-9940 with your questions. Those chosen will be answered on the air. Call 212-582-9940. That's 212-582-9940. Sorry, we cannot accept collect calls. Remember, Black Leader 73 will be shown nationally at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Tuesday, May 15th.
All I got to say for you is,
Mother Leroy Jones, in your mouth.
Leroy's no but a pygmy. Yeah.
Racist swab.
And there's other little degenerate monkeys.
I believe the towers will be built unless, you know, some white boy drops out of the clouds, you know, with some illegal legality, you know, that's gonna make it impossible or something like that. But in terms of the way it is now, we're gonna build it.
The racial confrontation is not going to end in Newark, and it's certainly not going to end in this country in the near future. I think we'll always have race and racial problems as long as people will not learn to live together. And apparently they're not going to learn in the next few years.
Senior citizens, like in the 80s and 90s, were forced to walk up 13 flights of stairs because the elevators never run. We have 1,206 families and only one policeman to protect the lives of all these people. During the winter seasons, we hardly ever have heat or hot water.
On September 15, 1971, at the regularly scheduled meeting of the Newark, New Jersey City Council, a white councilman representing one of the few remaining predominantly white areas of the city asked the approval of a tax abatement for a proposed housing development to be built in his district. All of the lawmakers present voted for the resolution. In such a fashion, a $6.4 million high-rise structure was born, its name, Kawaida Towers. A year later, the project's sponsors met at the proposed site for groundbreaking ceremonies. Much to the surprise of the white area residents, the sponsors were all black. With this discovery, the whites shouted racism. When they learned that their own councilman had paved the way for the project's approval, they charged subversion. However, when it was learned that black nationalist Imamu Baraka was connected with the building, whites adopted more drastic measures and began a full-force campaign to prevent construction. Although Newark has the greatest percentage of slum housing in the nation, white residents, led by State Assemblyman Anthony Imperial, have in effect blocked work on the building site since November 1971. The majority of the construction workers are white, and they have consistently refused to cross picket lines. Six black workers show up daily and perform whatever small tasks they can. Repeated court action has proven mostly ineffective. White pickets and blacks at the site are restricted to separate areas. The situation has been reduced to a battle of noise.
Most of the land in the Central Ward is tied up in urban renewal, and this land was available, so we got it. So we felt that since, you know, nationalist organizations are always talking about the need to transform the community, and the people identify, I think, nationalists and Pan-Africanists more with rhetoric than, you know, concrete delivery of goods and services, we wanted to demonstrate that our concerns were the same as the general community's concerns, that is, better housing, schools, you know, the same things that the average brother or sister understands as being necessary, you know, to transform our condition. Those are the things that we're trying to deliver, you see. But when we try, we're obstructed, you see. People tell us that we're not constructive, and then we try to be constructive, and then that's obstructive. We disagree with the philosophy of most of the builders of buildings all over this town. I mean, they're capitalists, you see, and we don't agree with that, you know. But we don't try to stop them from building.
So. How do you see the stand of the opposing side? Do you think they have a valid argument?
Well, the argument is based on Anthony Imperiale's need for, you know, political notoriety. That's basically it. As far as them having a valid, you know, concept, I mean, it's just racist. I mean, he can get them, you know, like quasi-emotional, you know, on the racist issue.
Some whites hid from our cameras. Anthony Imperiale, head of a North Newark citizens group, was one of few whites who consented to be interviewed by Black Journal.
We don't need it. The city of Newark was built a long time ago on black and white, and many people living together. I lived with black all my life, but not this kind of black like Jones, who desecrates the image of God and desecrates a man because it's not within his thinking. And I don't think that we should subject our children or anyone to it. It's just that this man represents something that other than American. And the people are afraid of it. They have a right to be afraid of it because it is a very dangerous enemy.
Imperiale, who admits that Newark is sorely in need of housing, is at the Kawaida site daily, greeting his supporters and picketers who refuse to allow construction workers in.
Thousands of dollars are lost each day construction is held up on Kawaida Towers. Imabu Baraka's organization, the Temple of Kawaida, has recently filed suit against labor unions for not honoring their contract to build. This, plus other incidents involving the alleged beatings of a black construction worker and members of the Kawaida Temple, has prompted an investigation by the Congressional Black Caucus. Black community support appears to be increasing, and the slogan among blacks is that Kawaida Towers will certainly rise.
I believe the towers will be built unless, you know, some white boy drops out of the clouds, you know, with some illegal legality, you know, that's going to make it impossible or something like that. But in terms of the way it is now, we're going to build it.
Months of court and months of picketing, our police won't enforce the law, our mayor won't even see the police enforce the law. You know, it's been like a hell of a crisis. The community actually didn't want to get involved in it. But it came to a point where brothers and sisters started getting beat, black laborers got beat, black policemen got smashed in the face yesterday, black policeman 2 weeks ago got his ankle broke, you know, by these same white policemen here. Not only they are beating our own people, Imamo Baraka organization, brothers in the organization, but they are beating their fellow comrades, the black policemen getting brutalized by policemen and those white pickets.
Well, if the criticisms are founded, we correct it by giving the protection that's lacking. But unfortunately, we cannot put a policeman on every corner. And if these incidents are occurring, they're not happening at the site. They're happening someplace else. And so far, we have no reports of any of that. I mean, it's just been rumor and unsubstantiated. And therefore, there's nothing we can really do about unsubstantiated rumor.
In order to be appointed permanent police director, Lieutenant Edward Kerr must not antagonize the majority white city council with his actions at the Kawaida Tower site. On the other hand, he is daily losing black support because of this middle-of-the-road position.
I found that a lot of people, they have a misconception about what the police role is. And no one has ever taken the time to explain to them just what our function is. They demand a lot of things that we cannot give by law or otherwise.
So what I'm saying is that we are not going to stand for none of our people get beat side of the head no more. We're not going to stand for the racists stopping us from building houses for our people. You know, we're not gonna stand for imperiality. We can't stand for that no longer. You got to understand what the problem now. See, the problem relates back to the same problem we were fighting in Kawaida Towers. Those six white racist city council that put the pressure on Mayor Kenny Gibson, and he danced to that pressure. You understand? He danced to that pressure.
Well, so far, what I've done is take the kind of general position that as long as a developer, such as the Kawaida Towers group, follows all of the rules and regulations and the laws, then they have a right to build. I've supported housing development in the city of Newark, regardless of what group, because of the need for housing. We need more housing probably than any city in the country. Legally, we are, of course, duty-bound to protect the rights of all citizens, to protect the rights of those who are going to build, hopefully. And we also have a right, we have an obligation to protect the rights of people who wish to demonstrate. And that's always a tough, you're caught in the middle in that kind of situation. I take the position that the housing project should be built. I would hope that all of those people who have said that they want housing in Newark would support that position. The problem here is going to be whether or not the tradesmen, the craft unions, the plumbers, carpenters, bricklayers, iron workers will cross the picket line. You can't really build a building without them. I believe that they will, as has been proven recently, that they will cross that picket line and the building will go up. You know, housing becomes emotional when people think that their neighborhood is being invaded. I think that this is a situation with Kawaida Towers. These things take time in solving, so we take no, you know, broad brush treatments, and we're going to solve it. What we do is to attempt to let things happen without heat and emotion.
The day that those crackers went down there and beat up a few brothers and this sort of thing, 10,000 black folks should have marched on that site and dared any cracker to come near. Really, that's my opinion. You know, got all these blood. You got 10,000 bloods who are just nodding their head. I mean, we got bloods all over the place. We got 300,000 black folk in this town. And we're gonna let some little white group push us around, you know.
Public housing in Newark, as in most other cities, is in a sad state of affairs. But the situation may be more intense here, as public housing tenants across the city have maintained the longest rent strike in the nation. 14% of all the city's residents live in public housing. The majority of them are black and poor. The rent strike began in 1970 with all 18 of the city public housing projects participating. Later, less than half of the public houses became the actual strike force. Included among the lengthy list of demands were extermination of rats and roaches, repair of elevators, cracked walls and plumbing units, and restoration of heat and hot water systems. In March of this year, the Newark Housing Authority threatened to evict 2,600 families from the striking projects. At that point, negotiations reopened and a tentative agreement was reached for a two-month moratorium on the evictions and the strike. During the strike, tenants paid their rents to the strike associations, which kept the money in escrow. One of the major tenant voices throughout the 3 years is Toby Henry, who was recently released from jail after serving a sentence for returning back rent to tenants. Some of the noise you will hear throughout this interview are the sounds of a deteriorating building.
For 3 years prior to the rent strike, attempts were made to negotiate and encourage the housing authority to sit down and talk about some of our grievances and problems. However, after realizing that those meetings and negotiation attempts were fruitless, a citywide rent boycott was launched April 1st, 1970. Some of the basic reasons for the boycott were things like elevators. At Stella right here, we have 20 elevators that never work. That forces not only people my age bracket and Hazel and some other folks, we have senior citizens like in the 80s and 90s who are forced to walk up 13 flights of stairs because the elevators never run. We have 1,206 families and only one policeman to protect the lives of all these people. During the winter seasons, we hardly ever have heat or hot water. We have approximately 4,000 young people in the community, yet there is no recreational facilities to so that they can burn up some of their energy. The problems are numerous, you know, and the attempts seem to be numerous in quantity, and very insufficient in anything, you know, in any type of a commitment by the housing authority. There's a large amount of land, vacant land in Newark, everybody's talking about it, so we want a piece of that. We're talking about control and monies. We're talking about being control of some money now. We're no longer talking about patching up a window and spraying our rat to get them out of your property. We want that, we need it, but we're also talking about more sophisticated things like building and controlling.
It's really dangerous living in these projects because just imagine, you're 3 o'clock in the morning, you smell smoke, and the first thing you think is your house is on fire, and the whole house is full of smoke. And you go up and there's this outside incinerator that's cluttering up your house with smoke. And that's dangerous too. I think it was Christmas or Thanksgiving. A lady had relatives over for dinner, sitting at the table, and a pipe busted in the wall. And all the water come down on her guests and everything. And it flooded our 42 families in that one building.
We were trying to get the people in the projects to form a security committee. We'd go around and check on people and chase people out of the hall that didn't live there or something like that. One of the representatives from that committee was Mr. Julius Threadcraft. We had a meeting, I don't know what day it was. Let's say, for example, it was a Monday night. We had a meeting about security, and he was going to write up a proposal to Senator Washington, as we've done many times. The next day, Mr. Threadcraft, who was one of the chairmen for this committee, was coming home from work. Parked his car, he got out of the car and went to the building. And after an hour, his wife got, because she saw him come out the car, came and got some of the lieutenants, and we came down to see what was happening. And we found him on the back stairs. Some guys, some junkies, had beat him and took four quarters from him, took his clothes off and poured water on him, beat him in the head, and he was unconscious for a week. And he died.
Let me just disassociate myself from public housing, first of all. That is run by a separate agency. I think I could do a much better job in administering that program, but we are not allowed to legally. The private housing situation. We have developed a rehabilitation program in the city of Newark. It's been cited as one of the best in the country. We have rehabilitated large numbers of units, apartments. We have attempted to expand that program, but the federal government, because of its holdbacks and cutbacks and moratoriums, have restricted the expansion of that program. So we're now caught into a situation of being able to do and not having the resources to continue. Well, we've already done a good job at. We have also another program of turnkey and scatter site housing, which we could implement if we could get the federal dollar released, those holdback funds released.
Perhaps one of the most outstanding aspects of much of Newark's black community is the tremendous amount of vacant garbage-strewn lots which extends for miles. This barren land represents areas where thousands of black people once lived, but their homes were condemned and torn down in the name of urban renewal. In the Central Ward alone, over 90 acres of land involving 14,000 living units were cleared for future projects. However, today, 2 years since the first home was demolished, with no new construction in progress, there is a certain skepticism among Newark blacks as to whether the intent was urban renewal or black removal. Although there were no previous barriers, the present freeze on housing funds makes construction impossible. As much as one-third of Newark's housing can be classified as substandard, and houses are being abandoned at the rate of one per day. Many white residents enjoy the luxury of fancy, high-rise living or spacious private homes on tree-lined streets that don't look at all like Newark. The contrast is at once both shocking and tragic, but also is the reality that black Newark faces daily.
Thank you.
people will say the reason there's a high rate of abandonment because is a social factor more than anything else, that people don't want to live in areas where they're where you have a crime problem, or where you have other, where an area where services are lacking, and so people will leave for that reason. Then there's the matter of taxes. We do have high taxes in the city. Rents are very high. People can't afford and will not pay high rents for these substandard structures or dwellings, and would rather vacate. Sometimes I can't even get a lot clean because maybe the white councilmen are making demands upon the public works director who's white to clean lots in their ward. And they got the power, so he goes with the power, not with the need. Whereas I may have 10 lots that need to be cleaned. They may have one. Theirs will get cleaned quicker than mine. But we have all the problems of any sick community that you would find across the nation.
Well, I guess it's the same as it is in any other major city. It's quite frustrating to most people because they've got to work hard, they've got to struggle. There are not that many benefits that they can see around them. Depressing sometimes looking around, and you wonder, well, you know, is it worth it all? But we've got to live here, we've got to raise our children here, so it's a necessity. And so we have to address ourselves to the needs that the community needs, address ourselves to preparing for the future for our children. And so it makes it imperative that we get together with one another, you know, and start dealing with these problems.
One thing we have accomplished, if we haven't accomplished any improvements in the conditions, is the awareness and the unity of the people.
We see our priorities as politics, education, and communication. We see those as the three basic needs for the black community to really transform itself.
Newark is too important to die. With Port Newark and Newark Airport, and this location on the eastern seaboard and all that, one of the largest office centers in the world, you know, it's gonna be a long time before we pull out the obituary on the city of Newark.
I would like to accomplish an improvement in basic city services. If we could just keep the streets clean in Newark, and that requires, of course, not only our efforts, but the efforts of the community. If we could make sure that the vacant lots were kept clean, if we could demolish abandoned buildings, which are basically fire traps, if we could learn how to provide proper police protection in all areas of the city, I'd be happy. I would want no more than that.
Thank you.